after a second U.S. journalist was beheaded by ISIS. The president promised, promising to degrade and destroy the Islamic militant group ISIS. Joining us in 710 KURV, U.S. Air Force veteran, retired CIA officer, Gary Bernstein. Gary, welcome to the show. What do you think the president is up to?
Well, the president is hedging his bets here. You know, he's using the word degrade. He should just be using the word destroy. He should be just addressing this. The problem is that ISIS and the presence of ISIS and their activities make clear the folly of the president's, you know, preemptive withdrawal from Iraq. We pulled out too quickly. We didn't stabilize this situation there. And this thing has gone south very, very rapidly and is presenting a danger to the region and the world.
In your mind, had the U.S. forces stayed in Iraq, it would have prevented ISIS from going into Iraq, right?
Well, we would have been able to stabilize Maliki's regime, and Maliki was truly a bad actor. And we shouldn't have left troops there to fight, but, you know, leaving a 10 to 20,000 man training force to stabilize, to have influence on the government, would have been a better
long-term. Kind of sounds like you're damned if you do, damned if you don't. We didn't want to support Maliki, but we had to stay at the same time. So, so eventually, at some point, you have to say, you know, we need to leave, and you guys need to figure out security on your own.
But the problem here wasn't just security. Look, we have left forces around the world in many of the places we have been over the last 50 years for political stability, not to fight, and to have influence on local governments. And we had none. And the president wasn't completely honest when he talked about the withdrawal, because what he said was that the Iraqis would not sign a status of forces. Maliki was actually prepared to sign a status of forces, but what the president wanted was he wanted their parliament to sign it, and it was a complicated political, issue in getting that parliament. We could have had an agreement executive to executive, but the president was looking for a rapid exit through the door.
So what would you say now, Gary, in Iraq, in Baghdad? Are lawmakers looking at each other and saying, okay, lesson learned. Next time, we'll ask for the U.S. help.
Well, I think that right now what we need to do is you have to understand, as we confront ISIS, ISIS is in a space between two failed states. The first failed state is Syria. The second failed state is Iraq. We cannot work with the Syrians. What we can do, some work with the Iraqis. We're going to have to stabilize that situation. We're going to have to bring the Sunnis back into the picture here, maybe create some sort of federal system or a system or encourage them to do that, and then use their ground forces, the majority of their ground forces, to fight and hold territory as we support with air and some special operations people. Not traditional ground forces on the ground, but a combination of CIA and special operations like we did during the 2001 invasion of Afghanistan.
Okay. All right. He's author of Jawbreaker, The Attack on Bin Laden and Al-Qaeda, a personal account by the CIA's key field commander. Gary Bernstein, our guest on 710 KURV.
Mr. Bernstein, Tim Sullivan here, and I don't think you can argue the matter about keeping troops in Iraq, whether or not, without also acknowledging 2003, that, we shouldn't have even gone into Iraq in the first place, because as despicable as a character as he was, I guarantee you if Saddam Hussein was still in power, ISIS would not be where it is.
Well, look, I'm the person that led CIA forces in Afghanistan, and they pulled forces away from us early, and we didn't stabilize Afghanistan because we went into Iraq preemptively, and I cannot argue with you on that point. But we are there now. We have a situation there that we're going to have to deal with, and the preemptive withdrawal was a problem. But still, we're going to have to build a coalition now. The United States should
not
be
fighting ISIS alone. And that takes time, doesn't
it? Excuse me?
That takes time, doesn't it?
Well, you've got to get on the phone right away, and you've got to get off the golf course to do that.
Well, I think that's what he is doing.
That golf course argument, I think, is pretty silly.
I don't want to downplay the threat here, but there is a need to get going on this. But it took the GW administration a few months to get into Afghanistan after 9/11. It took a couple of years to plan.
It didn't take that long to get in there, sir. It took us about 10 days. We had CIA forces on the ground in Afghanistan 10 days after 9/11.
I mean, troops. A coalition. And
we had special forces there 30 days after that.
Okay.
So we had large forces very,
but it did
very
take
rapidly.
Some time, and ISIS is a different situation than the Taliban. So
can
we kind of keep our heads together a little bit, maybe be a bit more patient here, and do what the president seems to be doing, a deliberate approach, and trying to avoid any mistakes that we may have made in Afghanistan and Iraq.
I'm not sure he's I think that the administration, quite frankly, sir, is overwhelmed right now. They really are. And this is not to say that this is simple. This is very, very complicated. And I understand the fact that this is complicated. But the point here is a recognition needs to be made that we need U.S. leadership in this, that the United States is moving very, very slowly in this, that we should have – there are many other things that we should have done. Look, in 1991, when George Herbert Walker Bush confronted the invasion of Kuwait, he had Jim Baker on the road immediately. We raised funds. And actually, Bush 41 is the model for this. Build a coalition, get others to support financially whatever the expenditures are. It's Bush 41 that should be the model for this.
Well, I think that's what's going on now here with the president overseas and talking with the British prime minister and a lot of other folks. It looks like that coalition building is starting to
come
together.
Hey, Gary, and in your mind, U.S. leadership would mean building that coalition, not ramping up to reinvade the territory and wipe these guys off the map, right?
Well, we're going to have – well, look, the truth is we've got forces on the ground already. The administration, of course, doesn't want to have to state that. But, you know, every 2 or 3 weeks, we've ramped up another couple of hundred.
Yeah.
This is going to continue. And because the fact is when U.S. power, air power comes in there, you're going to need special operators on the ground to coordinate the air power. The Peshmerga fight very well.
Yeah.
Some elements of the Iraqi army fight well. But if you're going to integrate air power into this, you have to have people.
And there seems to be more movement.
Part of the Iraqi army fights well. Kind of confused about
give it
that
to the
one.
Kurds. They'll fight. There's a movement to give them more arms as well. Gary Bernson, a U.S. Air Force veteran, retired CIA officer, and author of Jawbreaker, our guest on 710 KURV.